You are live now.
Great, thank you. Kia ora and good morning to everyone on the panel. Good evening to those joining us from the US and good day to everyone else. Thank you, Representative Wells, Senator Bragg, and Representative Coffey for joining us today in what I expect to be an engaging conversation. Thank you to those in the Zoom audience for attending. We are looking forward to hearing your questions. Please feel free to put questions in the chat at any time. If we have time at the end, we will allow people to verbally ask questions towards the end of the event. Annika Wells is a Labour Party member of the Australian House of Representatives for the Division of Lilley in Queensland. Andrew Bragg is a Liberal Party Australian Senator from New South Wales. And Tamati Coffey is a Labour Party member of the New Zealand Parliament representing Wairiki, a Maori electorate. I've had the pleasure of spending time with everyone on this panel during their ACYPL exchange programs, and I'm thrilled to be speaking with you all once again for this ACYPL International Town Hall that we've decided to call the Rundown Down Under, because we're very funny and clever. Though in many ways, the suffering caused by the COVID-19 virus is a shared experience globally, the steps taken by individual nations to confront the disease and subsequent economic fallout have differed dramatically, making the reality for individual people remarkably different depending on where they live in the world. For instance, in Wuhan, China, where the virus is thought to have originated, thousands recently packed into a water park in the city, and schools are reopening any day now. In South Korea, fans have returned to stadiums to enjoy baseball games. African nations continue to report many fewer cases than expected. Meanwhile, the U.S. is reporting daily COVID cases in the tens of thousands, and India is reporting roughly 90,000 cases a day and rising. Every country has responded to this crisis differently from a public health standpoint, with varying levels of testing, through contact tracing mechanisms, stringency of mandatory lockdowns, social distancing, and mask requirements. Every country has responded differently from an economic standpoint, with different strategies of economic relief for individuals and business, from lump sum cash payments to stimulus payouts for corporations and small businesses, to rent and eviction and mortgage payment freezes. We are here today speaking with leaders from Australia and New Zealand to discuss what their government response was to the COVID-19 pandemic and hopefully take away some best practices and lessons learned. Annika, I'd like to start with you. For our viewers from outside Australia, which is most of them, can you briefly describe the government response in Australia, beginning with the initial steps taken to combat the spread of COVID-19?
Sure. Thank you, Pete. It's a delight to see you again. Any excuse from my end? And may I also acknowledge the Aboriginal elders on and custodians of the land on which I speak to you from today, the Turrbal and the Jagera people here in, I'm in suburban Brisbane, which is the capital of the tropical state of Queensland. So I'm a member of the federal opposition. For us, we sat in parliament regularly in the first week of March. And I remember there was a bit of discussion then about Wuhan and cases appearing in other countries. And there was a question mark put over whether or not we would return to parliament 2 weeks later. But I remember the sense very much being, this isn't going to be something that affects Australia. Probably not. Things would resume as normal. And less than 2 weeks later, we had cases come to Australia. The Prime Minister suspended the parliament for 5 months. So we didn't return 2 weeks later in at the end of March. Instead, the Prime Minister formed what he called the National Cabinet, which comprises of himself and the premiers of each of the states that we have here in Australia, which obviously are far fewer than you have in America. So it made it a working group of about sort of 10 or so people who were, I think, meeting via Zoom, etc., every 48 hours at the start. I think in a bipartisan way, it worked really well to start off with. People sort of just triaged the urgent things about the international borders coming down. I think New Zealand was quicker than us on that front, so I'm looking forward to hearing about how they did it across the ditch. Bringing down the international borders, what social distancing measures were going to come in. But I think at all points, it's most noteworthy for Australia that this was done mostly on a state-by-state basis. And so we've had varied results across the different states. 6 months on, Parliament has had to resume at several points to pass major pieces of legislation to institute a federal wage subsidy, some other schemes that have, we might get into a bit later, I think, the economic elements of the response to COVID compared to the health elements that are very much delivered by the states here in Australia. Under the Australian Constitution, many powers are referred out to the states by the Constitution, mostly our service delivery. So things like health and what is now a very contentious political issue, but aged care, some parts are looked after by the states and some parts remain with the Commonwealth. IR, for example, remains with the Commonwealth. So there's been of late much discussion about what state of health the Federation is in and how it's held up under the strain of a national pandemic. I might leave it there just to keep it broad, but I'm happy to sort of deep dive into any of those things as you wish, Pete.
Sure. Yeah, thank you. Andrew, is there anything you'd like to add as far as kind of successes in kind of bipartisan work, you know, working together across party to make the right decisions for Australia as related to the pandemic?
I mean, effectively, the way you judge success here is on the health front and on the economic front. And in many countries, I know that there have been discussions about the trade-offs where they occur. I guess what we've tried to do as much as possible in Australia is to try and work collaboratively across our federation, because Australia, like the United States, is a federation where the central government has some power, but a lot of the powers are also held by the states. And so, I mean, the principal policies that were deployed were to institute an international border closure, and then to roll out quite a significant wage subsidy, as well as on the health front, you know, very high level of testing and in most jurisdictions, quite successful contact tracing, which has meant that where there have been outbreaks, they have been contained. Now, there have been, you know, mixed results within the states. But I mean, overall, when you look at the contraction in growth in Australia, we've contracted by 7%. That compares to, you know, the UK and New Zealand that have contracted by 20% each. These are the sort of countries we compare ourselves against on a regular basis. Our judgment is that has been a reasonable position for Australia comparatively. But, you know, the challenge for us is really, you know, how we, because we're now in the first recession we've had for 30 years, which is almost as long as Annika and I have been alive. So the challenge for us now is, and there'll be different views about how we do this, but how we avoid wasting the crisis. But in aggregate, in summary, I think comparatively the economic stuff has been pretty solid, and the health side of things has really differed depending on which state of Australia you're currently residing in.
Right. So Andrew, your state of New South Wales has done pretty remarkably well. Same thing with Queensland, Annika, if I'm not mistaken. Why is Victoria struggling so much? Before we jump to New Zealand, I just wanted to ask you, you know, follow up with you all about the variance in how these states are responding and why there's such a difference in case numbers.
Well, for people who know Australia, I mean, the major population bases are on the eastern seaboard. And so the state I represent is New South Wales. It's the biggest state in Australia. It's about 9 million people who live in this state. And Sydney is in New South Wales, which is Australia's global city. So we had some major problems at the start of the year or in March. But subsequently, we have been able to keep our economy open in New South Wales. And these are not the judgments of my national government. These are the judgments of the state government. They've been able to keep the borders open, the internal borders open, the economy open, and have had very successful contact tracing and testing regimes, which have meant that we've been able to deal with outbreaks. So what's happened is when there have been outbreaks in parts of Sydney, they've locked down those, what we call in Australia, local government areas, rather than closing down the whole state or the whole city. And then they've been able to trace those people through contact tracing expertise, and then we've just kept going. Whereas I'll stop here and let Annika add in, but my sense of what's happened in Victoria, which is the second biggest state, is Unfortunately, they've had some significant breaches of hotel quarantine. They had overseas travellers coming back to Melbourne. And that has kind of has gotten out of control. And the major problem they've had is that their contact tracing has not been at a global standard. It's been actually, frankly, we found out this week, it's been sort of paper-based. And so they couldn't deal with it effectively.
Annika, is there anything you'd like to add?
Yeah, I think that's largely on the money. Victoria is experiencing a second wave, which is now, as Andrew said, in recent evidence, being attributed entirely to an outbreak based on the quarantine measures taken in inner city hotels for incoming passengers to Australia, be that people returning home, well, it has to be people returning home. I think two things to note about that. One, Victoria was bearing, alongside New South Wales, the greatest burden of numbers for international guests, international visitors. So just statistically, they were more likely to cop it. But like Andrew said, the contact tracing employed by different states has made the difference here. And basically, Victoria had this huge outbreak of community transmission that just, for a number of reasons, wasn't contained quickly enough. And now they've got this sort of entire second wave. And I think the other thing which might be interesting for people from different parts of America is that one of the reasons that Queensland and, to an extent, New South Wales have been so successful is we are used to dealing with natural disasters in our state. We're one of those sort of constantly besieged by fires or floods or cyclones, what you might call hurricanes, I think. So our emergency management is impeccable, and our services, they're used to dealing with these kinds of mass rollouts very quickly. So that was one of the elements that has come in handy comparatively to other states that haven't had to deal with that so much.
Right, that's interesting. Yeah, it wasn't long before the COVID outbreak that Australia was dealing with those horrendous fires. You know, it seems like ages ago, but you know, that makes sense. We have our share of natural disasters in the US, but perhaps we don't deal with them quite as well as you all do in Australia. Moving down or moving across to New Zealand, Kia ora tamati, thanks for your patience. I know we're all excited to hear, your story from New Zealand. Tons of attention New Zealand's gotten lately internationally for just a pretty remarkable response, I think. So I just wanted to touch on that. So as you know, in late June, New Zealand recorded its first two cases of COVID. By comparison, on June 30th alone, the U.S. recorded 43,865 new cases. The state of Alabama, with a comparable population to New Zealand, recorded 854 new cases that day, and numerous other countries were recording daily new cases in the thousands. So I was wondering if you could explain the measures that were taken by the New Zealand government as early as February, months before the first two cases, including the alerts level system, and why such an approach was appropriate in your view.
Yeah. First of all, kia ora everybody. Thanks for having me. Look, our gift is our curse here in New Zealand. We're at the bottom of the world, and what we got to see was COVID rolling out all across the world. So we saw it start in China. We saw it start to spread to some of the other big countries around. We sat and we watched, actually. We had the fortunate ability to be able to sit and watch what the reactions from other governments were. And so what we did was we monitored it. We monitored it really closely. And when we started realizing that we were starting to have our own community outbreaks here in New Zealand, I think we had about three or four of them. First of all, weddings. They were generally social occasions. I think there was a wedding down in Southland, not too far from here, an hour away from me. There was some drinks at a pub. I think it was somebody's birthday. But there started to be these clusters, and it started to spread quite quickly. So with that, the Prime Minister made the really bold decision to close the borders, which was pretty unprecedented, actually. Here in New Zealand, we rely on tourism. We rely on free flow of people in and out of New Zealand. We're very frequent travellers around the world. So closing the borders was not an easy decision to make. But it was done with the best interests of New Zealanders at heart. And I think that's part of what made it so successful, was that New Zealanders understood that the best way to get out of this ditch that we're in was to first of all close the borders, then to manage the health response. So testing stations were set up all over New Zealand. People were encouraged to go in if they were feeling the symptoms. There was a levels guide that was put out, level 4 being the most strict of restrictions. And the Prime Minister made the announcement that we moved up through level 1 to level 2 very quickly. And then within 2 days, we were at level 4. So level 4 meant that everybody had to stay home. They had to self-isolate. And they had to basically stay in their own little bubble. Bubbles became common terminology. Bubbles and Zoom meetings became our new normal. So that's how we were managing things. But you know what? The government response would have been nothing without the compliance of New Zealanders. And because we knew that when it comes to poor health outcomes, that Māori people are disproportionately represented right across the board, we knew that we had to do something really quickly. The Prime Minister said it repetitively. The best response was to go hard and go early. And that's exactly what we did. We closed our borders. We made people self-isolate. People chose to do that of their own free will, which was great. But obviously we coupled that with a bit of an economic response in terms of support. We enacted the wage subsidy scheme. A large amount of money was distributed out to businesses to be able to funnel back to their employees to be able to keep them in employment, because what we also didn't want was mass unemployment and lots of people lining up at the dole queues. So that was actually quite highly successful. We were in lockdown for 4 weeks. Every day we had daily updates from the Director General of Health and from the Prime Minister. So it became regular viewing. And for everybody that was really nervous at that time, it was really welcome actually that the Prime Minister and our top health official was there reassuring us, giving us the numbers on how many tests had been conducted that day, how many fatalities we had recorded, and just giving everybody a bit of peace of mind that we were in control of the situation. That was huge. We'd never experienced anything like that before. I mean, you know, we like to think that we plan for lots of things, but in terms of a pandemic on that kind of scale, we had no idea that it was going to be as big and as wide-reaching as it was. We made it through those alert levels. We actually ended up doing 6 weeks in total. By then, everybody was going a little bit crazy. Our kids had been learning how to be educated at home. We set up an education channel for the kids to be able to learn from, which was great. Teachers were swinging in to help. Everybody put their shoulder to the wheel. To be able to do what we had to do to be able to keep our people safe. And I think that's the biggest commonality, was that we knew we had a threat, a very imminent threat, and we all needed to be part of the solution. And for that reason, the Prime Minister was referring to us as a country as the team of 5 million. And actually what that did was created some real unity amongst New Zealanders to say that we're part of that team. We've all got a role to play. And we needed to swing into action. Fortunately, we were able to come back down through the level system. We're currently, as a country, on level 2 at the moment, which means that there are still restrictions in place. Social distancing still has to apply. When you're inside, if you're in a big area and you're with people that aren't your workmates, then actually mask and use of masks to be able to manage the health response is necessary. But we've experienced a bit of a second wave. I wouldn't call it a huge wave on Donald Trump kind of proportions. He singled us out for having lost the plot, and you know we've lost control of it. We haven't. Yesterday we had 4 new cases recorded, 2 of which are in the community and 2 at the managed isolation facility. So we still have closed borders. We're still managing everybody that's coming in into these managed isolation facilities. We've just made the announcement that actually, if you are coming in, there will be a payment to be made, unless you're actually a New Zealander coming home for good. And then obviously you can stay a lot longer. But yeah, it's been trying times. It's been troubling times. And we're still not out of the woods yet. We're still not complacent. But I think as a country, we're pretty proud of how we've responded to this.
Thank you. You know, I've got a couple of questions from the audience that I want to go ahead and have an answer. The first we'll put for our Australians, Andrew or Annika, if you'd like to take this one, is from Joe Village. He's had the pleasure of visiting both countries, and he wants to know, when do you expect to relax your entry requirements to allow tourists and nomadic Americans wanting to escape our own politics?
I think the latest we've heard from our Qantas and Virgin, who are our national carriers, is that they're expecting international flights to resume June.
That's very controversial. Very controversial.
That's the official word. I think the difficulty with the island paradise is that there's a number of state elections coming up, and people are very fond of these closed borders. So I don't think you'll see too many people advocating for it. You might advocate for it, Andrew. You're a senator.
Well, I do, but I just have to pick up a couple of things. I mean, Australia has one national carrier, which is called Qantas. We don't have two national carriers, but in terms of international, I mean, at the moment we have a very regrettable situation where we have some state internal borders closed, which I won't get into any further. But I think your question is really about visiting Australia. So there's really two parts to it. Firstly, we have taken the unprecedented step, which I'm not particularly enamored with, which is basically issuing exit permits. So you sort of need an exit permit to leave Australia, which I don't think is desirable. And then there's also a very small limit of people that are allowed to visit Australia. Now, the choke point here is hotel quarantine. Now, because it's been such a disaster in Melbourne, which is Australia's second biggest city, they're not doing any hotel quarantine at the moment. So we really need our state. I mean, this is the challenge of Federation, that we really are relying on the states to up their hotel quarantine capacity so that we can do, 5,000 people a day and therefore have more flights come into Brisbane or Sydney. I mean, I don't think anyone would want to go to Melbourne maybe ever again. But I'm sure that people want to go to Melbourne one day. But yeah, look, it's really the choke point is hotel quarantine. Mm.
Sorry, Annika, please continue.
I was going to say that my electorate takes in our state capital airport. And so the two airline carriers are the two that's left after sort of the economic impact of COVID. And a fun fact, which obviously isn't fun at all, is that Easter Sunday last year, 18,000 passengers came through Brisbane International Airport. And on Easter Sunday this year, 16 passengers came through Brisbane International Airport because of what Andrew said, the international restrictions on travel. We have a state election here in Queensland on Halloween, not a word of a lie, it's the 31st of October. So I think a lot of people are looking towards that election as the litmus test for how people are feeling about strong borders, for one, how tough we go on things like opening back up international and regional travel, because states like mine, tourism is the second biggest export for us, and not having everybody come to the Great Barrier Reef and to Kakadu and all those kinds of things obviously has a huge impact on our local economy. So it will be interesting to see what people want as of 31 October, whether they want the health concerns to triumph and to keep the borders shut, or whether they want the economy open back up to allow sort of tourism to recover.
Fair enough. Tamati, I have a question directed for you from the audience, but before, can you share any insider's view on when I might be able to come to New Zealand and have a cheeky snifter with you?
I think your only way at the moment, Pete, is if you're intending to marry somebody, so I can set you up if you're really keen. Seriously though.
We'll talk about that offline.
The only people coming through the borders at the moment are New Zealand citizens, are New Zealand residents, permanent residents that have the ability to be here. I was with the Prime Minister just this week in my electorate, and one of the things that she alluded to was the fact that we might see, at some point we'll start seeing a diminishing amount of New Zealanders coming home, and at that point we might be able to start having the conversation about who is at the top of our list to come in. Now we've actually got a really large international student population who have been waiting to come into New Zealand and obviously are academic institutions are waiting for them to come back too, and suffering because they're not here. So there's an argument to bring them in, and there has been a lot of pressure from that sector. But actually, I think the first cabs off the rank will probably be the partners of New Zealand citizens and permanent residents who have for some reason been caught overseas without their partner, and you know, because of their immigration status, haven't been able to get here to be with their family. So there's a strong argument to make sure that they're a priority. And also, there are some really specialised jobs that New Zealanders aren't able to do. Yesterday, I visited a hydrogen plant in the south of my electorate, and there are only a few people around the world that can run, install, manage these hydrogen facilities. And so being able to bring in really specialist people with specialist skills like that, there's also a really strong argument for, and the Prime Minister confirmed that this week.
Interesting. Well, I understand that Joe and I aren't at the top of your priority list, but I would like to come to New Zealand at some point. So I have one more question for you from Sarah. She's curious to learn more about the education channel that you mentioned. Was this through a public TV station or through the internet?
Yeah, it was set up, well, actually both. So one of the, I've spoken with quite a few teachers and they were amazed at how quickly our Ministry of Education were able to pivot what was normal for students to the new normal, which was a public TV station where kids could switch over to Channel X and actually get their daily dose of TV programs, which were being made during that small time in the lockdown, specifically for kids that had to stay home and didn't have any access to the internet. We've still got little black spots around the country where students are unable to access the internet. So that was something that became quite apparent, actually. And so that public TV station was set up strictly for that purpose. For those kids that did have internet access, it was a lot easier, though. The Ministry of Education had set up online channels for kids to be able to click into, not least their own schools that had their ability to be able to create their online classrooms and do their learning online. I think the biggest part of the shock was actually parents who suddenly felt as though they were hosting a school within their lounge or their kitchen, and their sons and daughters were in there with the laptops, with the books out and all that kind of stuff. So it came as a bit of a shock to some parents, but education-wise, actually we did pretty good on that front.
We have that
challenging.
Our national broadcaster put together there were channels designed just for children, but they put together an education one, and it started off kind of at toddler education level and then got more advanced across the day. So when childcare centres shut, we could put our toddler, you know, at 9 o'clock in front of the TV, and you could tell when it had sort of gone above her level of comprehension, because she'd wander back out onto the deck, because it obviously moved to sort of 4 or 5 year old teaching levels. So you could kind of insert your child and give yourself a break from homeschooling at different points of the day. But I think something that merits broader discussion that we probably won't have time for today, but is worth at least noting, is that the measures that have allowed people to work from home has almost exacerbated some of the inequality that we have in our society. So, you know, people like me who are a middle-class, white-collar woman have benefited hugely from some of these remote measures that have come in during COVID. For example, our parliaments had to introduce some virtual elements to allow people who couldn't escape quarantine and travel to Canberra to participate. Nonetheless, that's been great. I'm currently 8 months pregnant, so, you know, having my community groups have to adapt to a Zoom environment means that I can still get around and do my work even when I'm immobile and can't get across to different parts of my electorate. So in some ways, this is really good for more inclusive participation from different parts of our society that currently find it hard to participate in the democratic process. But by the same token, what we were just discussing there, what Tamara was saying, is that it really exacerbates the inequality gap. If you're a kid who doesn't have access to the internet, or whose parents aren't around and able to homeschool you to make sure that you keep up with your peers through this school year. If you're in casual work and that means that you aren't able to work from your, you know, veranda at home for extensive periods of time, or you can't get childcare, then this has made those elements much worse in comparison to other people on your street. So it'll be interesting to see how different governments prioritise that as part of the recovery.
Thanks, Annika. So I do want to move on to economics, but we just had one more question come in and I really want to get to as many as we can. This is from Barry Wong, who traveled to Australia in 1995. He's curious if Australia and New Zealand had any difficulties securing PPEs and also whether citizens were generally compliant with wearing masks, social distancing, and reducing large gatherings. There's been some difficulties with that in the US, so I think he's curious what the situation is in Australia and New Zealand. Tamati, do you wanna start?
Sure, yeah. We had a supply of PPE that went out to those people that were in frontline services. We kept our essential services going. So the hospitals, the nurses, the home care workers were all still expected to go out and do their essential work. In terms of PPE, we did have a stock of them. Did we have enough? No. Did we need more? Yes. Did some companies, some organisations go internationally for their own supply? Yeah, that happened too. One thing that we also discovered in the process was that we had a mask making factory down in one of our smaller centres here in New Zealand, and that been kind of kicked into remission for a wee while. But they were the new heroes actually when we found out that we had one of these places in our own backyard. Even the Prime Minister, when she was able to, went down to go and visit them and say thank you for the obviously extra supply that they were putting out. Another innovative thing that I was seeing over that time, because people were the appetite was insatiable for PPE. Everybody wanted it. Everybody was making up their own. And so some people were actually 3D printing their own masks. And before we went into the level 4 lockdown, some classrooms had their 3D printer, students gathered around, all figured out how they could make the little piece that would go around your head with the little plastic covering on the front of it. There was some great innovative stuff. We've kind of relaxed our take on that. There's been a lot more encouragement to be able to allow people to stay home and make their own masks, because we also don't want that kind of pollution of disused masks into the environment as well. So people are being encouraged at all levels to make their own masks, decorate it up with whatever pattern they would like. And just to demonstrate.
Did you make that one yourself?
No. I got this from the chemist, but I really like the flowers.
Yeah, they're awesome. Annika, you had a reaction when I asked about the compliance for wearing masks and social distancing. were there any issues?
Well, I guess not compared to my observations from the States. I think if anything, we've got almost like a copycat rear guard action happening in Australia for people who've now observed the I don't know how you classify them, the people who are resisting that in the States. But, and I'm conscious that I just spoke for a long time before, but like America, we had a mass shortage of COVID tests to start off with. So the issue initially was that they wouldn't let most people get tested. You had to sort of have three or four different red flags before you qualified for a test in the first place. Then there was a shortage of PPE across the board, particularly in our aged care facilities, some of which is still happening. We only moved to masks. Victoria moved to masks in their second wave lockdown. Before that, we didn't have that requirement in Australia at all because people were staying home. I think despite being a nation of convicts, we were surprised by the discipline with which people obeyed the rules, to the extent that the observance is the rule. And if you do get caught breaking the rules, there's sort of these national stories where, like, the Aspen Five, which were these sort of group of very affluent skiers who went to Aspen and then came back and went to their holiday home rather than their normal residence in Melbourne, got absolutely pilloried across the country for weeks for not following the rules. And we've had a couple of these tall poppy flare-ups that suggests that nationally we are far more compliant, perhaps, than we've given ourselves credit for previously.
Got it. I just want to pivot to the economy. Perhaps I have a couple questions. The first one is for you, Andrew. Your background is in economics and finance, and you sit on several committees in Parliament that craft policies in these areas. You mentioned that Australia is entering the first recession in 30 years as a direct result of the economic slowdown. I was just wondering, you know, you touched on it earlier, but I was wondering if you could walk us through what major steps have been taken by federal and state governments to avoid business foreclosures, bankruptcies, and other economic consequences of actions that were meant to curb the spread of the disease.
Well, it's very regrettable that we have entered the recession, and a lot of the people that have lost their roles, there's an enormous human side to all this. But I think we need to look at the comparisons. And as I say, we have shrunk by 7% in the most recent national accounts, which is, you know, vastly less than, as I say, the UK, which has shrunk by 20%, and New Zealand, which has shrunk by 20% as well. So we're in a reasonable position. And in fact, we're in a much better position than the OECD average here. So that's good. I've always taken the view that Australia is as a capital importing nation, really doesn't have much scope to be too complacent. I mean, we desperately need more foreign investment. And so the opportunity we have now is to try and use this recession to get some important, you know, tax and workplace law reforms through. I guess the success to date in performing comparatively strongly has come from our policies, which have been designed to keep businesses intact. And so there's been a wage subsidy, which has been paid to workplaces in order to keep the workers employed. But there's also been interventions through the central bank, loans provided, guarantees provided in order to keep the private economy going. But I have to say to you that this is not a sustainable system. I mean, we have racked up a lot of debt, which is not unique in Australian parlance, but we have a lot of debt. We have spent a lot of money to try and keep the economy afloat. And even despite all that, we've still shrunk by 7% in the last quarter. So, forgive me for being, we can kind of talk about what's worked and what hasn't worked. But comparatively, from a health point of view, in terms of mortality, in terms of community transmission, and then in terms of economic performance, we are at the top of the world in terms of our performance. And that's what I think you wanted to know about today. But I guess I'm more interested in how we go forward from here. The big risks for Australia are that there is a sense of complacency which besets the organisation, besets the nation, where we feel that we can be closed forever. We can have these internal border closures, which are reckless and illiberal. And then there is this sense that the government can keep on paying for, you know, people to not do anything, which will wreck the place. So, coming out of the last significant, in the last century, we've had a world war, we've had the Depression. I mean, the most comparable economic downturn is probably the Depression. And what we learned from that is that, you know, raising taxes, for example, would only prolong the recovery. So we've really got to be, I think, realistic that the only way to create new roles is to get the private economy to invest. And so Australia is not a socialist paradise. And so that's what we'll need to try and do. So I look forward to working with my parliamentary colleagues on that agenda.
Fair enough. And you all do work together and came into Parliament at the same time, is that right?
Yeah, we get along like a house on fire all the time.
Yeah, well, I feel like you finished on Socialist Paradise to give me my cue in to respond.
Yeah, and Annika, I just want to raise one question from alumni Dustin Manwaring, who submitted it before this started, mentioning the government debt He wanted to know how real the fear of the government debt is and whether or not it can spur underinvestment in government services. Is that a fear that you have?
Well, I'd note that two-thirds of the government's debt existed before COVID. And obviously, this isn't a partisan event, so I won't analyse further blame shifting on that front since COVID. But I think the thing about COVID is it's like an x-ray in that it's lighting up everything that was already systemically wrong. And for me, and I think for my side, who are currently in opposition, you know, since GFC, we've had this huge uptick in the casualisation of the workforce and insecure work that has been worsened by the state of the economy that has deteriorated so quickly under COVID. As Andrew has flagged, the government sees the answer to this as further deregulation of our federal IR system, tax cuts for companies. I don't think that making work more insecure and more unregulated helps workers, particularly casualised workers, people who don't. I mean, if you're a casual in Australia, you didn't qualify for the wage subsidy system scheme that is currently still operating in Australia. 1.1 million casuals out. So we will be having a big battle in the next 12 to 18 months before the federal election about, I suspect, alternative visions for recovery, being whether an IR system needs to be further deregulated to support private investment, or whether casualisation and insecure work creates more problems for the economy than those proposed outcomes. Our side is saying that there is no jobs plan, and the government needs to provide a jobs plan. Specifically, the way to do that should be investing in renewable energy and things like social housing that gives private companies opportunities to invest, but also helps some of these inequities that structurally have widened because of the circumstances of the year. So that's the frame, I think, at the moment for the coming election.
Interesting. Tamati, are similar conversations happening in New Zealand relating to, you know, the path forward?
Yeah, absolutely. We're all very much focused on the economic response right now, knowing that we still won't be out of the woods until we've tackled the health response and we've actually, you know, eliminated COVID from our borders. But look, in terms of support, I won't underestimate or understate just how important the wage subsidy scheme was and being able to get that out really, really quickly. You know, we've got a population of 5 million here. I think 1.8 million New Zealanders benefited from the wage subsidy scheme. For those people, those businesses that applied for it, it got out in record time. And governments aren't known for getting money out in very short periods of time. So actually, for businesses to be relaying that they applied for the wage subsidy on the Monday and it was in by the Wednesday was actually a testament to our ability to respond really nimbly to the crisis that was at hand. So we had the wage subsidy. We extended that when we took the lockdown a little longer. And just in the latest resurgence, we've actually implemented that again. So there's been that. Another thing that we've done to be able to support our small medium businesses has implemented the small business loan scheme. So really favourable conditions. You can take it out over 5 years, up to $100,000 if you've got 50 employees or less. For the first year, you don't have to pay any interest. For the first 2 years, you don't have to make any repayments, and you take it out over that five-year period. So businesses that I know have been taking advantage of that. Because it is such a favourable arrangement. So there's that we've put in place. The industry that's really hurting at the moment is obviously our tourism industry. And as Annika said before, you know, we thrive on tourism. It's a huge earner for us here in New Zealand. So we've had to give them special support, make sure that they were able to keep their businesses going. The Minister of Tourism made a really bold statement when he said, in tourism, we can't save every single job. There is just not the ability to keep everybody that works in tourism on the government payroll until we're out of this, because we also don't know when we're out of this. We also didn't want to put in place a kind of a faux target, as in we'll be out of this by Christmas, we'll be out of this by Easter, because we just don't know. So having some extra support for our tourism industry has been valuable. Basically, our strategic tourism assets, those ones that we really, really couldn't let go of, they were given extra support, went through a process, a grant and a loan was made available to some of those businesses, and that's allowed them to keep ticking over. We've thrown in big support around digital capability as well. While the borders are closed, the online borders aren't closed. So being able to make sure that their online presence is really good, making sure that they're ready for when the borders open has been really critical. And what we've seen is actually a sharper product from all of our tourism operators being able to market, first of all, to New Zealanders, because many of them have had to have the conversation of saying, well, we're used to marketing to Americans, to Australians, but actually what do New Zealanders want when they come to a hāngi and a concert show with a Māori cultural group up on the stage? So a lot of them have had to do that sharpening of their tools to understand what exactly it is that they're selling, what exactly they want. But tourism, right where I am right here in Rotorua, we are the birthplace of tourism in New Zealand. But, you know, again, we had the Prime Minister here just this week, and she put out a real message of hope and said, in the scale of New Zealand's history, this is a blip, you know, and we will get through this. There will be an end to this, and actually we shouldn't give up hope. We shouldn't be chucking the towel in, because actually there is a light at the end of the tunnel. We will get through this. We had an eruption which decimated our local tourism industry here over 100 years ago, about 120 years ago, and we got through that. At the time, obviously, it was big, it was disastrous, but we made it through, and our tourism industry is still the jewel in our crown. But actually, I heard one of the panelists earlier saying that there's a lot of support for keeping those borders closed. New Zealanders really like being able to check out our own country and get out there and experience it and do it with that kind of confidence that actually we do have a handle on the health situation, and actually there's nothing better than getting out and seeing your own backyard.
Yeah, well, I sincerely appreciate your optimism, Tamati. It's, you know, it's a tough time. So I agree, New Zealand will persevere with leadership like this. Annika, I just wanted to just go back to what you were saying a little bit earlier about support for casual workers. You have a background in social justice issues and social justice law. Does the economic effects of COVID kind of open up or display kind of larger social justice issues in society? Can you just go into a little bit more detail about that?
Well, I think the X-ray analogy stands in that it really sort of lights up what was already structurally broken, has exacerbated some of those gaps. So I suspect it is the same for you in the States, but for us, the immediate impacts of the COVID recession have vastly affected women more than men, because they are in industries that have been more grossly affected, like our sort of care economy, like childcare, hospitality, retail, hotel industries are all sort of female dominated workforces. They're the people whose industries have been most decimated by restrictions, and also whose industries were least likely to have been supplemented by federal schemes like the wage subsidy. My side's been seeking specific interventions, largely without success, to try and fill some of those gaps. But it is a problem of growing inequality. And I imagine, again, like the States, for us, our younger generations, the millennials and the Gen Z workforce, also are the most drastically affected out of COVID. And these are generations that were already starting to experience labour force scarring, because millennials entered the workforce during and immediately after the GFC. So many people went to university hoping to get into a particular industry, had to take a lower level job in an unrelated degree, hoping to hop across to the ladder they wanted to climb later. 10 years on, they haven't managed to hop across to the ladder they want to be on at all, and are actually taking up lower positions that then prevent people further down the rungs from getting even secure work, as opposed to insecure and casualised work. Again, all those things have been exacerbated by COVID, and I think without a more interventionist government stand to make some of the divisions within this country even worse, which is, I think, from a social justice perspective, difficult and something that we should be working to avoid.
Thank you. Yeah, it wasn't that long ago that I graduated college, and it just must be such a difficult time to graduate right now. I can't even imagine, really. Well, thank you. I just have a couple more questions, and there's a couple more questions that were in the chat that I wanted to mention. But before I get to them, I wanted to go back to Tamati. Kind of touched on this earlier, but you know, the U.S. Center for Disease Control reports that in the U.S., Black people are about 2.5 more times to contract COVID and about 2 times more likely to die from it. The New Zealand Herald reported that members of the Maori population are 50% more likely to die from COVID than Pākehā or white New Zealanders. These are findings, at least in the U.S., that are consistent with the fact that Blacks are more likely to have underlying health conditions that make them more vulnerable to COVID. So I ask you this because you represent the Maori people, and I just want to know, what do you think accounts for this discrepancy in health outcomes when it comes to COVID, and whether or not that exposes any underlying issues?
Great point. Sad point, though, too. Our Māori people, unfortunately, here in New Zealand, have got a health system that has systemic failings for our Indigenous population. That's not disputed. And one of the reasons that I'm even in Parliament is to try and turn some of those bad outcomes around. But Māori are at the bottom of the statistics when you're talking about respiratory illness, heart conditions, obesity, diabetes, liver problems, kidney problems, you name it. That's a pre-existing condition. And when you know, COVID hit, and we learned that immunocompromised people that suffered from these types of illnesses were going to be front and centre, and we're going to have to battle through this more severely than others. That's why we knew that we couldn't muck around with any kind of, postcode lottery lockdown or any kind of anything less than the total goal of elimination, because we knew that our Māori population, we've suffered from the effects of colonisation here in New Zealand, and we're still trying to reverse that now. But we knew that we couldn't muck around with anything other than that, because we knew that our population, our Māori, our Indigenous population, had to be protected. For that reason, we actually had small pockets of Māori communities that implemented their own checkpoints, which was something that they wanted to do to be able to protect themselves. I want to use the example that far up the coast, in the eastern part of my electorate, they decided to implement their own checkpoint as well. When they raised the idea, we brought them together with the police as well and said, can we come to some kind of arrangement here? These people are passionate about their community. They don't want to see a repeat of what happened when the influenza epidemic hit New Zealand in the late 1910s, and hundreds and thousands of Māoris died. I correct myself, thousands of Māori died, and there are big tombs which serve as reminders of how when you don't tackle this problem head on, that actually it can go really pear-shaped and have fatal consequences. So they wanted to get involved, they wanted to put in place their own checkpoints, and we actually saw a number of them popping up around the country as a response to communities wanting to make sure that they could best protect their older people, but also their populations that had compromised immunity.
Thanks, Tamati, and you both for talking about, how we can best protect kind of underserved populations, whether it's in Australia or New Zealand. There's a lot of discussion about that in the US right now. But I want to switch gears. I think we lost Andrew for maybe the near future. Maybe he'll pop back in, but I think we have time for one, maybe two more questions from the audience. So I'm just going to jump in. This is a question for Australia. So this is going to you, Annika. Have trade issues with China had any measurable economic impact or is the economic downturn vastly from COVID?
From COVID. The trade stuff with China has been heating up in the past couple of weeks, which I presume is the premise of the question. But largely they have been threats rather than, Andrew and I were actually in, I think it was Wisconsin with our friend, Chris Larson, who I think is on the line, shout out to Chris, when President Trump instituted some of those trade tariffs. So nothing comparable here, but we are just enormously dependent upon our trade relationship with China. It's a shame that Andrew's hopped up because this is a particular pet policy love of his. I would say there are very mixed views in Australia about this. Certainly the government has been doing its best to preserve the relationship, but it's like it really is a bit of a moving feast. I'm sorry, I can't be a bit more specific about where it's headed at the moment. I'm afraid. Yeah.
No, that's okay. There's another question that was similar. There's a couple questions about China, but another attendee was curious. You know, he said he visited New Zealand and Australia a couple years ago, and there was skepticism about the relationship with Beijing, but the economics made it so productive. So his question is, I guess for either Tamati or Annika, has that shifted, and has America's quote volatile leadership on the global stage fundamentally changed the US's relationship with your nation? So kind of relationship with China and the US relationship with New Zealand and Australia.
I think that's true. I mean, I think Australians are a skeptical people by nature. And certainly the way that the US has changed how it conducts itself on a global stage, can I summarize it as has sort of given a different perspective, but our PM has been doing a lot of work to build up the Quad, which is sort of our regional multilateral relationships with Japan and South Korea and India, so that we as a, you know, comparatively smaller player have more ability to negotiate about regional outcomes with China rather than it being sort of entirely reliant upon a bilateral relationship. So I guess and, you know, being the multicultural melting pot that we are, that is a bit more reflective of our communities as well. So my hope is that that will continue to build up in the months to come. But it's a good question because it's a very interesting time. Tensions are escalating on that front.
Yeah. Tommy, do you want to add to that, or I also have another question I can throw your way?
Yeah, go for the other question. Just a note to say that as the little island at the bottom of the sea, we're friends with everybody.
We're lovers, not fighters.
Well, with that smile, it's really no surprise. So Sarah has another question. We've covered the tourism sector quite a lot. Her question is, how is the nonprofit sector performing, holding up, raising money during COVID? I assume the nonprofit sectors are quite a bit different in Australia, New Zealand to the US, but that's the question.
Yeah. Good question. In fact, what we've noticed is that our community groups who are sometimes reliant on funding from even gaming trusts, the inability for people to be able to go out and do what they normally do. We have, instead of casinos here, anybody that gambles, there's kind of a portion of that goes back into the fund, and community groups can apply for that kind of funding. But in the absence of people going out and doing that kind of stuff, actually our community groups have been hurting. So there's been an absolute focus on making sure that our community groups, who generally are at the coalface and dealing with our people on the ground day in, day out, the big problems that they face. There's been a focus from the government to make sure that they're supported as well, not to mention our ethnic communities as well. So we've developed little funds to make sure that that our community groups are looked after at this time. But I'll chuck into community groups. Also, our arts scene has been kind of brought to its knees as well, because obviously we pride ourselves on our arts and culture over here too. But again, without any tours, any events going on, everybody's in shutdown mode. Actually, our arts sector is on its knees too. So whilst, yes, we're keeping an eye on our businesses and making sure that our small, medium enterprises are being looked after, we're also keeping our eye on all of our community and our NGOs to be able to build their capability, build their resilience as well, and especially those groups that deal with our underserved communities.
Thanks, Tomaji. So we are at 8:01. Annika, do you have one more question, time for one more question, if it's from Chris Larson, your good friend?
Of course I do, though I do want to tempt you with one very colourful snippet from Australian politics in the past, 24 hours, if you've got time.
Please.
So it's a shame Andrew's not here, but he's in the state of New South Wales. New South Wales is currently run by a coalition government. The Premier there has been putting in place some legislation to protect koala habitats. I know our American friends are very concerned about us preserving our koalas and our kangaroos.
We are.
Perfectly sensible legislation to protect their natural habitats. They obviously got decimated in the bushfires last summer. But the coalition government governs in partnership with the Nationals, who look after the interests of the farmers. And in the past 24 hours, they have absolutely blown up over this legislation and are demanding that instead farmers reserve the right to massacre koalas on their land as needed. And they've actually threatened to walk away from coalition government over the issue, which is now known as the Koala Wars. So there was last night they said they would walk away from coalition government in order to preserve their right to massacre koalas. The Premier said, not on my watch. If you're going to join the crossbench, you can't retain your positions in coalition government as ministers. They had until 9 a.m. this morning, which is 8 p.m. your time, to relinquish their ministries or move to the crossbench. And it's just come through that they have backed down and the koalas will live. So I thought that your audience would be interested in that just little snapshot of 24 hours in Australia, but also that the koalas will live.
Thanks, Annika. That's good news. All of our delegates come back praising the koalas. We would like to borrow a couple if that's okay. I'm trying to let Chris in to actually verbally ask the question. It's my first time trying to use the tool, so I may just read the question myself because he put it in the chat. But I wanted to have him say it in his voice. But seeing as I cannot figure out how to do that, and I don't see his hand raised, I'm going to ask the question. So Chris says, as we're dealing with politically charged debate around what version of a vaccine is acceptable. Chris raised his hand. Sorry. Let's see if I can do it. Ah, there he is. Hey, Chris.
Hey, how's it going? Can you hear me?
Yes.
Oh, that's awesome. Okay. How's it going, Annika? Good to see you. Good to see you, Pete.
Good to hear you.
I'll hear you. Yeah, yeah. Well, I see you guys. Anyway, I'll just do a question. We can talk offline. Basically, we're dealing with a very politically charged debate around what version of a vaccine is acceptable, with hints that a vaccine might drop right before the election and then trying to, for the purposes of polls. And so there's been a debate around what's acceptable and what version will be allowed to expand. So I'm curious is how you are facing it in your countries of the two big concerns, right? How safe is safe enough for the vaccine before it gets distributed? And then how are you deciding who gets it first?
Mm. Thanks, Chris.
Thanks.
Tomati, do you want to go first or do you want me to? Tomati? In Australia, we're a few steps back from that. The federal government's only just secured two in principle agreements to obtain vaccines from the Oxford trials and University of Queensland trials up here in my state. their estimations of timing for vaccines aren't until March at the earliest next year. So we're a few steps behind where you are in terms of rollout. We have a much stronger national culture around immunisation. So for us, the anti-vaxxers are very much the outliers. And I mean, we get, for example, Gardasil, which is a sort of cervical cancer vaccine, is administered to all females during high school. So we just have a higher acceptance of vaccines in our country. So I don't think it's as inflammatory here with the, you know, with the Facebook outlier exceptions as you have experienced. But I'm interested to hear about New Zealand, Tomati.
Yeah. I am too. And actually, the vaccine strategy isn't something that I've delved into, but I've actually just gone and looked it up, and turns out, we've actually been contributing not just to our own efforts here in New Zealand to be able to find a vaccine, but also contributing financially as well to international research to make sure that that we're committing ourselves that way. But I think from what I'm seeing, that the general hope is that if there is a vaccine, that actually we're making sure that we're positioning ourselves so that we can actually be in the line, hopefully somewhere near the front, to be able to get access to that as well. But I know that we've got our own scientists that are on board on top of this particular thing of finding a vaccine for New Zealanders. I can only think that we would take a big exhale when we do find that there's a vaccine. We're not opposed to vaccinations here in New Zealand. Of course, there's still a portion of the population that are, but I can only think that when there is announcement about some kind of vaccination, that we'll be there ready to contribute, but also ready to vaccinate ourselves as well.
Sorry, I was muted. Thanks, Tomati and Annika and Chris for the question. Senator Andrew Bragg, wherever he is, maybe it was some internet connectivity. We ran out of time today. We've gone a little bit over, but it was such a fun, interesting conversation for me. I know that our participants enjoyed it too, because they've already been texting Libby, the CEO, saying how great it was. So thank you, Annika. Thank you, Tomati, for taking the time out to talk to us today. It was great to see your faces. Making me very nostalgic about the time that we got to spend together in the US.
Tomati would agree with me when I say we look forward to welcoming you all when you're allowed back in.
Absolutely, 100%. 100%.
When I saw that Wisconsin was getting the Democratic convention, I actually had hopes that I might be able to get over there because we had such a good time with ACYPL there, but not to be this year.
Next time. All right. Have a great day, you all. And thanks again.
Thanks,
Kate. Have a good evening.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you, everybody, for joining.
Night, everyone.